This particular dish is called Buddha jumping over the wall.
Oh, jumping over the wall.
Yeah. So this is mullet fish roe.
すごい!
いただきます!
いただきます! Yes!
Hey everyone, it's Jason Wang, and welcome to Jason's Table Shocked and Surprised, where we're looking at some of Taiwan's unique, surprising, and maybe shocking foods. Today, at Jason's Table, we have a special guest, Sumi.
Hi, nice Jason, nice to see you too.
Thank you for coming here.
So glad to hear.
Brian.
Hi there, nice
Hello.
To meet you.
Hello, Jason. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Julian, Jason, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too, Jason.
Thank you for coming. I'm so glad you're here, and the topic of the day is symbolic Lunar New Year foods. Today's game is we're going to be looking at three different symbolic foods that are served around New Year's time, and I'm going to ask you some questions about
okay.
it. If you get the questions right, then I give you a prize at the end.
Yes, okay.
Yeah.
Not
and
yet.
If you don't get the questions right, then you get a punishment, but we won't tell you what that is right now. Okay?
Oh, okay.
Sound good. So let's bring on our first dish. So this is what is known as 乌鱼子 in Chinese.
Don't swear, please.
Oh, no, no, no. It's not swear. 乌鱼子 is mullet fish roe.
Okay.
So it's the eggs of the fish that have been salted and dried and pressed.
Wow. Yeah. I love that.
Okay. I know Japanese. Karasumi.
Karasumi.
Yes. Oh, okay. Yes. Oh, karasumi. Oh. So, okay, I know.
So that's what this is. And I think in many different cultures, they're preserved fish roes. This is a very expensive dish for New Year's.
Yes.
Around 1 gram costs around $30. So it's expensive in Japan too, right?
Yeah, karasumi? Yeah, but that, oh, that expensive.
It's very expensive, yeah.
Whoa.
So the question for you is, traditionally in Taiwan, and maybe you know this already, what is the traditional way of preparing this for eating? Is it going to be deep fried? Or is it going to be soaked in alcohol and then grilled?
Cooked? I actually don't think I really knew that it was cooked in any way. I just thought it was, I know that, I mean, whenever you get it, it's usually sliced into really thin slices. Yeah. But definitely not deep fried. So I'm gonna go with soaked in alcohol and then grilled.
Okay.
In Taiwan, you know there's a night market?
Yeah.
Everything is deep fried.
Everything fried, yeah.
So I think they're deep fried and eat. This is a traditional way in Taiwan.
All right.
Okay, I'll go deep fried.
Deep fried?
Yeah.
Okay. Is Yuli correct?
Am I?
Is the mullet roe traditionally eaten deep fried for Chinese New Year?
No!
All right, is it soaked and then grilled?
Yes!
Yes! Oh, thank heavens. Oh, scared myself for a second there.
So the traditional way is in fact to have it soaked in alcohol, and then you grill it to get some color on the outside to toast it a little bit. And then just like you said, it's sliced and then served. Should we taste it? Let's taste it.
Let's go for it.
Sumi, we found out that the traditional way, just like in Japan, is to grill it or roast it.
Yes.
So here is how they do it in Taiwan. What is it? What's going on here?
Is it water or alcohol?
Does it smell like water? It smells a little... stronger, right?
Sake.
So this is a type of liquor that the mullet roe is soaking in, and we poked a couple holes in to help it absorb.
Oh, wait, really?
Go around here, and we let it toast around, and we'll keep going until it gets a little, you can see the flame now, right?
It's going.
Okay, so I'm gonna just grill. So we toast it until the outside's a little bit crispy, and then we'll slice it, and then we will serve it. So after this is toasted, you would take it to the kitchen, you'd slice it up, and then it's traditionally served with onion.
Itadakimasu. Itadakimasu, yes. I thought it's like a really fishy smell, but it's not.
Okay. Okay. Wow.
Wow good or wow bad?
Wow. Surprising. Wow. Surprising. Totally. I like it.
It's really, really salty. Really, really salty.
Yeah.
Fishy. Oh,
okay, so it has a little bit of oceanic breeze to it.
And then...
I mean, I think for me, I noticed the texture first.
The texture is definitely...
It's a little bit gummy. And like slightly stuck to your teeth kind of feeling.
It's really dense too. Yeah.
So delicious, interesting, unusual. This is Wu Yu's. So you are one for one.
One for one so far.
Got it correct, but we have two other foods to try. Let's see the next thing.
All right.
This is known as longevity vegetables. So, 常年菜. And traditionally, it is in the northern part of Taiwan, mm-hmm. around Chinese New Year's, it is eaten, it's mustard green. Mm-hmm. But in the southern part, sometimes it's spinach, mm-hmm. as well. So this particular vegetable, there is a special way of eating it, mm-hmm. During the Chinese New Year. In order to have longevity, mm-hmm. for the upcoming year and prosperity, mm-hmm. Do you A, have to eat it in one bite?
One bite.
Or B, do you have to have an elder, mm-hmm. like a grandma, mm-hmm. or like your parents, hold the vegetable for you while you're eating it?
That's very weird, but I think that's the Taiwanese style. Because you are at home during the new year, right?
Yeah.
And you have nothing to do, so probably that's what we do.
So they come up with ways to entertain themselves.
Kind of, okay. Yeah.
Generally speaking, if it's something for long life, then yeah. you don't want to like... break it up too much, sure. so eating it in one bite is probably the way to go.
There's a tradition in Japan. We eat like whole roll sushi. So I think this is similar stuff. This is long too.
Okay.
I will go A.
So is Sumi correct?
Yes!
Yay!
Really? Really?
Is Yuli correct?
No!
Come on.
The proper way to eat this for Chinese New Year's is to eat it in one bite. The reason being that they think that the vegetable represents like a long life.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't want to cut it or break it because mm-hmm. then you shorten your life.
Makes sense.
So you have to eat the whole thing. So yeah. I think similar thing with like noodles as well.
Okay.
Yeah, so unbroken noodles, long noodles means long life, longevity.
Mm.
So please, let's taste test. Are you ready?
Let's go.
There you go.
Is it long? Yeah, it's a lot.
And I'll go for this one.
Okay.
Whoa, he's a fast eater.
I remember. It's impossible. Jason, you're great. Oh,
Jason, good.
Yes. Whoa.
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 Japanese competitive eating shows. Mm. Okay, congratulations. We did it. And we didn't die. So that's very important. So I'm gonna let you keep chewing and...
give me some time.
You did in fact get this correct. So you are one for one and we're gonna go on to the next dish while we still finish chewing. This particular dish is called Fo Tiao Qiang, which is Buddha or monk jumping over the wall.
Oh, jumping over the wall.
Yeah, so it's a very interesting dish and it is everything is piled into this ceramic container.
Yeah,
and then it's sealed and then it's stewed. So this dish was originally from the Qing dynasty and there was an emperor who kind of got tired of eating all the food.
Mm-hmm.
So he told the chef and he said, the head cook, you gotta create something really special, unique, or else I'm gonna, right? So he put everything he had into a container and put it to cook. Turns out that the smell of this was so fragrant,
so
delicious,
good.
That even next door there was a monk who was, you know, he was like, what is that delicious smell? So he jumped over the wall to come to the kitchen to take a look.
Oh, wow! Yeah.
And turns out the dish was delicious, the emperor loved it, and so he didn't get. And that was the dish. So it's called Buddha Jumps Over the Wall.
Wow.
So please go ahead.
The name.
There's all sorts of things in here.
so rich. And the meat is so soft, so tender.
Everything is delicious. So can you show everyone what do you have right there?
Wow, this is abalone.
Yeah, there's abalone, tiny abalone. There's all sorts of, there's water chestnut, there's quail eggs, there's taro root traditionally. Wow. There's a delicious broth, there's ham. There is like sea cucumber, sometimes shark's fin, but all sorts of dried, expensive ingredients.
Okay.
And it's all cooked in this earthenware vessel for a long time to let all the flavors melt. Taro.
This is so good. You know what? I want to have it with me.
You want to take this? Yeah. Can we get this to go for him afterwards?
Please.
This particular dish has very important meanings in Taiwanese culture. Does this dish, A, indicate how much rainfall has been falling in the past year, the average rainfall amount? Or B, is it an indicator of the consumer price index, which is like how well the economy is doing? Because, you know, I think it's really interesting. A lot of vegetables, especially root vegetables, if there's a lot of water in the rainfall, the vegetable becomes looser, and then sometimes like potatoes are denser and things like that. So it's quite possible it could be rainfall.
Okay, I think I'll get your hint and I'll go for rain then.
Feels like the seafood elements would be probably the most expensive in it. Yeah. I'm gonna go with it tells how Taiwan's price index is doing, and I have absolutely no idea if I'm wrong.
Inside, the ingredient is so expensive. So if the ingredient, the stuff is less, then probably the economic is not good, right? So I go with A.
A, the consumer price index?
Yes.
Is indicated by this Buddha jumping over the wall.
I think so.
Okay, is Sumi correct?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
Congratulations. Oh.
What hints are you giving me?
I don't know, I'm just... Okay, so in fact, it's an indicator of the consumer price index. And that's because a lot of the ingredients in here are so expensive that if this year it costs, you know, 1,300 Taiwan dollars and next year it costs like 2,000, people can know that the prices for things are more expensive. Okay. So they use that to gauge the economy.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah. So now you know, it all makes sense,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, a lot of sense, yeah.
But as a result of having three incorrect answers, you have to, don't go anywhere. I have something for you. I have something. How do you say, what do you say before you drink things?
Budimo.
Budimo, okay. All right, so you.
I will say three times. Budimo, budimo, budimo. And the people will answer, hey, hey, hey.
Okay,
and then cheers. Budimo, budimo, budimo.
Hey, hey, hey.
Cheers.
Oh, cheers. All right, there you go.
It is difficult to...
It has an aftertaste too.
Yeah,
Yuli, I appreciate it. You're a really good sport. Today we got to try three really interesting symbolic New Year's dishes. And I think for all cultures around the world, New Year's a time to spend with your family, new beginnings, thinking about good things to happen in the new year. So this is Jason's table, shocked and surprised. And I guess we'll see you next time. Thanks for coming, Yuli. Bye.
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 Thanks for having me.
Bye.
Bye.